I can confirm that we will be rolling out the vaccine for the general population using age cohorts. That means it will help us manage both demand and supply, and also that we'll be able to communicate nationally when we're ready to start vaccinating the next age band.
That was Jacinda Ardern at a press conference with details about the vaccine rollout for the second half of this year. New Zealand is currently among the last countries in the world, or the developed world, for vaccination progress. But how should we assess the vaccine rollout? Our panel this morning, Dr. Api Talemaitoga from the Pacifica Medical Association, NZME's Head of Business, Fran O'Sullivan, and economic commentator Bernard Hickey. Tēnā koutou. I'm going to start with a question for each of you. Api, is the vaccine rollout going well?
It could be better. I think we were a bit ambitious with vaccine targets and we weren't quite sure about our supply chain. What I found disappointing is we didn't use the learnings from COVID last year, where we knew that if we got the messaging right with Pacifica, with Māori communities, that we could get more engagement. It's happening now, but it's been a bit slow. It is still encouraging to see that we're a bit ahead of schedule and the vaccine concerns or hesitancy has dropped quite a bit.
That's certainly good to see. You know, it's interesting to note the government says that it is ahead of its projections or targets overall at the moment.
Yeah.
But in Tāmaki Makaurau and in the Counties Manukau DHB, they are quite substantially behind their targets at the moment, which must be a concern.
It is a concern, and this is why I think we could have been smarter at the messaging. We could have thought about the venues that would work, going to churches, that infrastructures that worked with the testing last year. We could have, now Auckland Regional Public Health has a phone line where if you've got a congregation that likes to be vaccinated together, you could book in a whole lot of people. Taupō, where if you have a church gathering and you have more than 30, ring their DHB and they'll come and vaccinate you. Our appointment systems and our people having to ring an 0800 number to make an appointment, it's all very well for, you know, people like us, but if you're a hard-working mum of six in South Auckland, ringing a number, waiting half an hour to an hour just doesn't work.
Fran, has the vaccine rollout gone well?
Well, I think what was interesting was the Prime Minister to Business New Zealand a month or so ago said July was going to be sticky and there was a potential we might run out of vaccines. And obviously there's been a bit of a pause in how the rollout is going. I think we could have been better prepared last year. We've had a lot of time to get a system in place for doing the vaccine rollout, and it's a bit hit and miss. Speaking personally, I've already had a number of texts inviting me to enrol. I already am enrolled, so I mean, for my first vaccination. So in that sense, there's obviously a bit of confusion in the system. My concern is that this is going to have to be an annual event from the sound of it, where we're going to have booster shots, or a bit like we do with flu, deal with, you know, a different variant that might arise. So in some ways we need to put in place that system that is actually going to be able to be used again and again until globally the pandemic is stamped out, if indeed it can be stamped out.
Bernard, is the vaccine rollout going well?
It's a bit haphazard in terms of when people are getting it, different ways that the different health boards are doing it. And I agree that we should have had more in place ready to go. The IT system is not properly rolled out yet. And there is a concern that we're not getting vaccinated as fast as everyone else. We're really limited by the supplies coming to us from Pfizer, but also some decisions we made last year not to basically pay over the odds to get the Pfizer vaccine earlier. However, I think, I mean, it's great that we can get vaccinated as fast as we can, end of the year, that's excellent, but we are really dependent on what happens in Australia because we're part of that bubble and we really don't go beyond Australia until Australia's done. And they have extra problems on top of ours, multiple vaccines, multiple governments, and they may not be ready, according to their own treasury, until mid-2022. That means I don't think we actually really open up the economy beyond Australia until the end of 2022, early 2023.
When you say that, you mean opening up the borders?
Beyond Australia.
Right.
That's right. Properly.
Fran, what, we saw the Prime Minister getting her first jab this week and the plan for the second half of this year, rolling the vaccine out via age groups. How do you think that will go in terms of stifling the criticism of the rollout?
Yeah, I think there's an age group issue, but I also think we need to be much more, I guess, picking up on Bernard's point about opening the economy and to other countries. Obviously, Singapore has been talked about by both Australia and New Zealand, but nothing firm yet. But we are going to have to get some of our business people out on the road. I mean, people are now talking about the need, Zoom's limitations, the need to actually go see, you know, investments offshore, meet with partners, in much the same way the government has said it wants to bring, you know, 200 high net worth investors into New Zealand to kick the tyres and, you know, do all of that. So face-to-face contact's essential. I think there needs to be a real emphasis to go out to those people who do need to go out there in the interests of jobs and the broader economy, make sure they're vaccinated quickly, irrespective of their age. I mean, they might be a 35-year-old rather than a 65-year-old. But
it's,
you know what I mean?
For me, Fran.
Yeah, well, I was thinking of you, Jack. And, but however, I think that needs to be a priority as well, not just thinking of people who might have physical vulnerabilities, which is important, but also thinking about people who do need to get out into the world.
Afi, how concerned are you about the situation in Fiji?
I'm very concerned, and it's sad because of a whole lot of reasons. One of it is the political situation, and part of the population do not really believe in the leadership. So when the leadership tries to give advice on what to do, health advice, it's not been listened to, and social media spreading misinformation that this is the government trying to control you rather than a public health response. I've been quite lucky, Jack, been part of the Ministry of Health's roadshow going around Pacific communities around the country here in New Zealand, but I've seen how each DHB has responded, and the smaller DHBs have done better, where they've actually, like Nelson Marlborough or Midlands, worked in with the community. So when grandma, Samoan ladies brought in for vaccination, they've offered it to the whole whānau to try and get the vaccine numbers up.
We also should take into account the real problems at the Waikato with the ransomware attack, which means that I know I've got lots of family and friends in the Waikato that it hasn't been great there because they've been really hammered hard.
Yeah.
So that will have to be considered. I mean, it's a big population area.
Now, Fran, you talked about the importance of face-to-face meetings and the economic recovery from COVID-19. Of course, Damien O'Connor has been in London this week meeting with his UK counterparts, sounding pretty optimistic about the FTA with the UK. He said to us, we should expect the same or an even better deal than the Australians. What do you think?
Well, we certainly have to have the same as the Australians. It would be odious otherwise, I'm afraid. You know, but however, I think one good thing about the Australians was because they had the G7 and because Scott Morrison went over, they were able to have, you know, the dinner with him, with Boris Johnson, and then announce that, the deal, essentially. So, I mean, that was a good waypoint. It's also helped us. We might be running a bit behind, but it's meant that we can accelerate the deal. I think, you know, one of the cards New Zealand also has is geopolitically, we are the depository for the CPTPP, which Britain is very anxious to get into. And so in that respect, you know, giving us a good deal would also help a little bit with the atmospherics on that. But it's a big move for the UK because it has been quite protectionist. The tariff rates have been quite exorbitant on some of our products like cheese and so forth outside of tariff-free quotas, which date back, you know, pre-EEC and Eurozone. But, you know, but there's other things. I mean, the way they frame the deal now is to look at what can you do about, you know, Indigenous side of things. So in other words, what do Māori want? Some side things around women and trade, Māori exports, also digital and so on. So there's a whole raft of stuff which sits outside of exporting goods, particularly agricultural goods.
I was particularly interested in the Australian deal, looking at labour mobility. Mm. And Damon O'Connor mentioned in his interview that's one of the discussion points. We export a lot of goods and services, but actually the people side of the trade, backpackers coming to New Zealand, New Zealanders going there for the OE. Australia managed to extract an increase in the age from 30 to 35 for people who are having OEs in the UK. And I know for a lot of New Zealanders who feel that COVID robbed them of the chance to do an OE in Britain, that would be a really useful thing to get. And for a lot of businesses, they are crying out for those British backpackers.
Yeah.
And that will be an interesting thing, whether the government offers up extra visa time or extensions for backpackers.
A couple of very interesting economic data points I wanted to ask you about this week. First of all, those pandemic-defying GDP figures, but also the new numbers out of the Real Estate Institute showing once again we're hitting record highs for New Zealand residential property. Does that mean that those tax changes the government announced aren't working?
Well, they haven't had the same impact, the impact that we thought, and neither has this apparent wafty, wavy finger to the Reserve Bank about not doing too much to pump up house prices anymore. That is, that's a concern for a lot of young New Zealanders who are currently, maybe they've got some skills, maybe they're not lucky enough to have parents who have equity, or they've married into a family that has equity in a home. They must be thinking, gee, I can get a 30-40% pay increase in Australia, and rents in the CBDs of Sydney, Melbourne and Brisbane have fallen during COVID, $50 to $100 a week, whereas ours in Wellington and Auckland are up $50 to $100 a week. And that's the real concern with the unaffordable housing, that we are bedding in, not only inequality, but offering up this huge
incentive
for Australian recruiters, and they're here, to hoover up our young people.
Yeah, are you surprised once again, Uppy, to see those numbers this week for real estate housing?
I am
surprised.
The most
expensive it's ever seen, yeah?
One of the things I wanted to say was there's not much good things out of COVID, but one of the things it did was shone the light on the overcrowding in houses for Pacifica families in South Auckland, 40%. And when they were diagnosed with COVID, were told to go home and self-isolate. Well, how do you do that in an overcrowded home? So it's really brought it to the fore and allowed the government to look at this as a primary policy initiative they should help
with. Just a couple of weeks ago, the government decided not to build the Mill Road roads, which would have opened up another 20 or 30,000 houses. I understand the climate change implications, but housing is the most important thing we can do for everyone. It hits everything, health, education, a lot. And that, as well as the Tauranga Road not going through, sends a message to the development community, actually we don't want to do things that quickly. And that was really disappointing. And we're just not getting fast enough action on housing supply from everyone, not just the government, but councils.
And Fran, do you share those concerns of Bernard that this might lead to some sort of exodus and contribute further to the labour shortage?
Oh, yeah. And it was made quite clear, actually, at the Auckland Future Summit, Future Now Summit, a month or so ago, when Anne Sherry, who is the Australian chair of the Australia-New Zealand Leadership Forum, basically pointed out, you know, this is exactly what's going to happen. Australians are going to come in here, get your best and brightest. They're also facing labour shortages. They've had everyone hermetically sealed over there, and they want to grow again. So again, it's offering our bright, good people who can't get ahead here outside of taking on onerous, ridiculous debt, you know, an opportunity to go and have a decent life somewhere else. And that's a big shame. It shouldn't be how it should be, but we've become really a very overpriced archipelago to live in, frankly.
Before we let you go, it is of course the weekend of the New Zealand First AGM and One News political reporter Mikey Sherman was one of many journalists yesterday trying to track down Winston Peters.
Winston Peters was playing hide and seek today. Here he is behind partner Jan, and here he is grabbing a cup of tea until, of course, he spots the camera, keeping his powder dry until his big speech.
Mr. Peters, could we have a quick chat, please?
You know the answer to that is no.
Yes, anyone would think that Winston Peters knew how to play the media. He's going to be addressing the AGM this afternoon.
Yeah.
I hate asking this question. Can we rule Winston out at this stage? Is New Zealand First on the comeback, Uppy?
Yes, you can't rule him out, I suppose. I'm much more interested in serious policy rather than personality politics. So
you won't be attending the AGM. Fran, what do you think?
No, I don't think we can rule Winston out. I mean, one of the things he did say that he was, you know, he's been looking after himself. He turned up at the China Business Summit, but skillfully stayed out of the way of any media there. But he's looking good. His partner's looking good. He will use this time to replenish himself spiritually, physically, you know, after, you know, just from the sense.
Spiritually? Hang on. What spirit are we talking about here, Fran?
His spirit. And, you know, in the sense of, you know, just having time out from politics, which is quite aggressive on people and their state of health and so on. Who else do they have? You know, they haven't brought forward anyone. Shane Jones was not able to make a hit in Northland. There was hope that he could secure a seat. And also, of course, that would have paved the way for the party to return to Parliament anyway. But that hasn't happened. And, you know, the younger blood hasn't really been given enough opportunity to shine. Mm. I mean, Winston dominates everything to a large degree from that party.
What do you think, Bennett?
And he's not been brilliant at bringing forward new leaders. Really, it's a one-man party. And he has done this before. Remember, he was out in 2008. He spent that 3 years. No one ever saw him. And we thought, oh, that's it. He's gone. And then back he comes. So
we rebuilt the party in that time. Yeah. And today and yesterday might be part of that.
Yeah. All right. Hey, thank you so much for your time and insights, guys. We really appreciate it. Bernard Hickey, Fran O'Sullivan and Dr. Api Talemaitoga.